that I would be coming to this event, I searched my mind, what's left of it, for the poems that I wrote in the Middle Kingdom in its earliest days. And there were three which I recalled, which I swore to myself I would come to three successive bardics at this event and perform. And this is the first one. I'm performing them, if I'm spared for the next 2 days, I'm performing them in the order in which they were composed. Now, the first one is a poem I wrote in honor and thanks to Baron Sir Torvald the Grim, the first Baron of Northwoods, for making me a pair of leather armbands, which he made with the assistance of the Guild of Exotic Dancers of Northwoods for reasons which I will reveal tomorrow night if I am spared. He being of a Norse persuasion, I set myself to write a drapa, which is a Norse praise poem. Unfortunately, as those who really know drapa will understand, at the time I had only the vaguest idea of how it worked. So if you mean, truly no drapa, I apologize in advance. I got the alliteration wrong, and it's much shorter than it should be, and so on. But way this works, keeping it simple, is there are a series of verses, each of which is linked by a refrain, and each verse has a telling of a piece of Norse legendary or Germanic legendary history or myth, which refers allusively to the event being praised. Now, you must understand that in order to create these armbands, which they wish to keep secret from me, the ladies of the Guild of Exotic Dancers blindfolded me and led me into a room where what it felt like they were doing was tying up my wrists. They were actually taking the measurements of my arms for the leather armbands, but I didn't realize that at the time. So, when I composed this poem, I chose three episodes from Norse or Germanic legendary history and myth, which all referred to persons who were prisoners, but for some grim, as usually in Germanic myth, reason were happy about it. And so the first verse refers to Hagen at the end of the Nibelungenlied. For those of you who are familiar with that story, he and King Gunther had been captured. Grimhild wants to know where the treasure of the Nibelungen is hidden. At that point, Gunther and Hagen are the only living men who know that. And Hagen, who is much the more steadfast character, is afraid that Gunther will break down and tell where it is. So he tells Kriemhild, I am Gunther's man. If you kill Gunther and show me his head, I will reveal the treasure. So she has Gunther's head cut off, brings it to Hagen and says, tell me where the treasure is. And he says, now I know I'm the only man on earth who knows where it is, and I will not tell you. Do what you will to me. And she says, you have paid me in false coin, but I have now retrieved Siegfried's sword, and she takes that and cuts off his head. But as you can see, he had a certain satisfaction in the situation. Now, the second one, I have to say, is a situation which, as regrettably often in Germanic myth, involves treating a woman in a way which we would not now consider acceptable. But Wayland, the smith of the gods, was captured by his enemy, King Nithard, and they took his hamstring him, so he was forced to slave for King Nithard in smithcraft. But he lured the king's sons in, killed them, I believe turned their heads into drinking cups, something of that sort. He then lured his daughter in, I think by promising her jewelry, and ravished her and begot a child on her, whereupon he made himself wings from the feathers of birds he had trapped and flew away. And so again, there was a certain grim satisfaction for Wayland, even though he had been a prisoner. The third one refers to the punishment of Loki, as most of you probably know, is the trickster god of the Norse, who finally pulled one too many tricks on the Norse gods. So they imprisoned him in an underground chamber with a serpent dripping flaming venom on him. His faithful wife sat beside him holding a bowl to catch the venom, but every so often the bowl became full and she had to go and empty it, and then the venom really fell on Loki and he writhed in agony. But it was prophesied that in Ragnarok, at the end of time, he would be loosed and join the Jotun, the evil giants, in fighting against the gods. So those are the three references. Each of them is about someone who, in some sense, was a prisoner, but in some sense was, in a rather grim sense, happy to be so. So goes, Hord Lord Hyder spied the head of the Lord he loved and roared with laughter. Now no Nibelung's ransom need, bitter are bonds, but joy so born. So Wayland, avenging on wailing virgin the thongs of his thrues that long had throttled his more than mortal fighter's might. Bitter are bonds, but joy so born. Loki shall lie till time shall loose. Terror from torment to war with Tor. Bitter as burning flame is burden. Bitter are bonds, but joy so born.